正经关不了，关不了正经。各位同学大家好，今天是一个特别具有意义的日子，今天是耶稣受难日，在西方叫做 Good Friday。 那么星期天是复活节，是耶稣复活的日子。耶稣被钉在十字架上，他没有罪，但是他用他的身体来为人类做了救赎，他用宝血洗净了每一个人的罪。今天我会分享复活节还有受难日的意义，但是我们今天还是要来探讨论文门，因为这件事情事关圣经或者耶稣不断强调的公平跟正义。而这当中呢，我们也看到人类各种各样的罪行。好，今天节目当中我们要谈的，要分享大家的是华雅电视推出了第六集的英文论文门，抢先跟大家一睹为快。在海外现在有非常多的人在努力的奔走，为台湾的人权日益恶化的这个事情呢，在努力的向世界各国发声跟求援。我们在节目中谈到 Jason Lee 的这个案子，这个事情真的就是非常的离谱。现在在台湾的民主社会当中，已经是一个资讯这么发达，民主进程到这样地步了，竟然还会发生像 Jason Lee 这样的一件事情。一个美国公民在 LA 长大出生，但是他的国语讲的还是挺不错，他的普通话讲的挺好。那么Jason Lee 的故事其实给了我们很多的启发。我们没有想到在2020年的今天，没有想到现在执政的是当年高举自由民主人权的民进党，在民进党内会发生这样的事情。我们尤其没有想到的是，发生这样的事情之后，整个政府整个党没有一个人站出来说一句公道话，可见这个党这个政府已经堕落到什么样的程度。那我们要提的是，这个 Jason Lee 他不过就是在3月28号的时候，把一个在网络上已经疯传的817万票可能坐票的种种的迹象的这样的一个影片或者是视频，把它 PO 在 YouTube 上。结果两天呢，有16万5千人在他被下架之前看到了他这个视频。他本来他的 YouTube 是一个没有什么人看，也没什么人订阅，可见这个议题有多少人关心，可见这个议题吸引了多少人的焦点跟目光。当然你可能会说都是那些韩粉，其实不尽然。我觉得每一件事情，当然一开始的时候看的人或者发声的人很多都是反对蔡英文的人，立场不同的人，但是也正是因为民主政治这个 check and balance， 每一个人因为立场不同，所以彼此制衡，于不一处有疑，才会发觉很多事情的真相。水门事件不是如此吗？ Zaev Gaddafi 的这个英国伦敦政经学院的卖学位的这个事件不是也是如此吗？有很多的事情都是因为起初的好奇心于不一处有疑，才慢慢揭发这个世界的黑暗面，让人类一步一步的更真完善，更真良善。好，那现在在海外的朋友们要非常感谢大家，大家很多人声援 Jason Lee。 Jason Lee 3月28号 PO 了这个影片之后，3月30号晚上8点钟，两个刑警到他家去按铃，然后叫他上去换衣服之后就直接带走，带到刑事警察局侦讯了两个小时啊，前后等待的时间加进去两个小时的时间，最后还跟他讲说你可能会被罚款2000元以上。那么在法律上面他还可能面临拘役啊，在选前还有一个反渗透法。其实像这样子的事情，如果今天真的要用一些比较严格的罪来扣在 Jason Lee 的身上，有没有可能呢？当然可能，因为说你有你就有。我没有想到这样的事情会发生在今天的台湾，让我这一个长期信奉或者是追随甚至为台湾的自由民主尽过一点点小小的力或者发声的人感到不可思议，匪夷所思。但它确实发生在台湾，所以 Jason Lee 这个事情其实给了我们有一个警钟，就是民主会从我们的手上一点一滴的流逝，如果我们继续保持沉默，像在 New England 的这个犹太纪念碑上面说的 First they came， 起初他们，当这些共党成员，当这些一个一个流失犹太人，或这些全部都不说话，社会民主主义，最后当他起身来抓我们的时候，就没有人再会为我们说话了。 所以今天台湾的良心，台湾的知识分子，不要再袖手旁观，要为台湾的人权尽一份力，不然有一天我们的人权在我们的手中慢慢流失的时候，你会发现赫然站在你家门口的虽然没有戴着白头盔，但是他们在今天所做的事情跟50年前做的事情没有两样，到那个时候 just too late。 好，今天在海外的朋友们呢，他们持续的在做联署，他们持续的把台湾目前的人权状况跟论文门的事情向国际发声，希望国际有更多的朋友们来声援。现在还在陆续进行当中的有好几个案子，大概已经到了累计到第10案。前面第一个案子非常可惜，功败垂成，三天就已经有23000人联署，但是后来这些数目慢慢的出现了很奇怪的变化，而这些东西呢，海外很多朋友已经把它做下记录，包括每一分每一秒钟的记录，还有包括后台这些东西都已经向美国的这个 FBI 去检举，是不是有外国势力或者有骇客的势力来侵入，阻止美国这个联署，在美国来讲是民主政治上面非常重要的一个环节。好，现在目前为止还陆续在进行当中的，包括了美国应该强烈抗议台湾总统提告三位教授毁谤，还有质疑白宫网站被骇客入侵，以及白宫的请愿联署遭到外界势力的迫害，包括了将蔡总统的博士论文列入世界纪录，美国必须支持台湾，但是并不是说谎的总统，我刚刚提到的是今世世界纪录。好，最近呢又出现了因为 Jason Lee 的这件事情，在4月7号有一个新的联署，是制止台湾总统连续霸凌美国公民，这一些联署的法案现在都在进行当中。因为案子很多，所以我没有办法一个一个告诉各位网址啊，我们会在节目中把它贴出来。各位，很重要的是你只要进入Google， 你去写说白宫联署啊，基本上就会出来相关的讨论跟所有的联署。然后呢，如果你不是很清楚怎么联署，找个朋友教你，顺便拉一票。这件事情不管能不能够在一个月之内累积到10万个联署，我想在海外的朋友们已经下定决心了，已经壮士断腕，他们要不断的接力联署下去，直到有一天引起美国的社会，包括舆论，包括美国的政界的重视，不然绝对不会罢休。在海外，在英国的部分也是，我们的律师团也都在进行当中，所以各位同学，你们不要担心，不要以为我们被摸头，但是不可能发生的事情，也不要因为这样以为我们一鼓作气再而衰三而竭，不可能。因为林焕昌教授、贺德芬教授，还有在海外的很多朋友们，他们都是地表上意志力无比坚强的人类，所以这种情况是不会被打压的。催助士其君，在其态世界，这个精神很多人都已经领受到了，会前仆后继接力的把台湾的人权、言论自由，还有揭穿这个36年的世纪大谎言的这一个世纪大使命给它传承下去。好，所以呢，这是现在海外的朋友们持续陆续在进行当中的，也有很多人呢要把这个 Jason Lee 的影像视频把它贴给 AIT， 贴给美国的白宫，贴过美国的行政部门，贴给美国的媒体，也听说现在已经有至少2家媒体想要采访 Jason Lee， 这些都是好事啊！因为当年台湾突破黑名单，解除戒严刑法100条，也是很多在美国的台湾人跟台湾社团共同努力，一点一滴的成为江河，才打破了这个黑幕。可是很可惜的是，还有一些人当年打破台湾黑名单、黑幕、刑法100条跟戒严的这些人，今天竟然因为意识形态立场跟政党的支持而支持了今天的蔡英文。我不是说今天的民进党跟蔡英文是完全不能支持的，但是前提是做了这样的事情之后，你的817万票，不管它是真的是假的，是不是该从票箱里面抽出来仔细的检视，这个人还值得你支持吗？讲到这个817万票，我认为纸棒莫若自修，最好的方法是面对这么多的质疑，这些票箱到底是怎么一回事。那么有人质疑票箱的透明度，有人质疑到票箱的底层，还有选票 还有那些明明就你可以看到啊，票投张三就马上去圈了李四，这些虽然零零星星，可能不足以影响选票，不足以让817万票这个翻盘，但是不要忘了，只要遇到这些不合理的事情、不公平的事情，今天的执政党、今天的中选会有义务要出来说明白，否则的话，这一个情况将会像滚雪球一样越滚越大。现在海外已经有朋友呢，他们把这个817万票这个网络上面质疑坐票的这样的一个影架，就是那个被下架的两支影片，全部翻成英文，会在美国、在加拿大、在英国各个地方去强力放送，而这个就不是你两个刑警可以到他们的门口去要求他们下架的。所以这件事情我只能说就是一个蔡奇太史简的一个例子啊，催助弑奇军的例子，你杀不了所有爱好公平正义的人，而这个行动恰恰是把这件事情呢，把它推向国际舞台的一个非常特别的行销手法，这个逆向行销手法已经让这个影片视频向国际之间发送了。今天呢，我们的节目当中还是会继续来探讨华亚电视在播出的第六集论文门的英文部分。进入广告之后呢，我们会来看华亚电视第六集的论文门。不过在这之前，我要跟大家分享一下，今天是受难日，英文叫做 Good Friday。 美国有12个州把这一天呢列为放假纪念，而且认为他们定为他们州的纪念日，在很多国家也是如此。我想基督徒都知道，不是基督徒呢可能不清楚，但今天因为这个重大的日子受难日，我要用一点时间来分享我的心得。耶稣是神的儿子，他被降临到马槽来到世上，是为了用他的一生来唤醒人类，用他的宝血来洗净每一个人的罪。我们都是罪人，我们亏缺了神的荣耀。这句话的意思就是我们都犯罪，犯了各式各样的罪，而圣经当中说到其中最大的罪叫做骄傲。那耶稣在30岁的时候，他在约旦河，在施洗约翰施洗之下，他受洗，受洗之后他进行了40天的禁食祷告，马上受到了魔鬼撒旦各种各样的试探。撒旦的试探其实在我们的人生当中到处都是，撒旦会跟我讲话说，哎呀，你不要再追这些论文门了，做一点妥协，荣华富贵都是你的，做点妥协，像那些在电视台的那些名嘴们，那些主持节目的人，一年赚个5000万有什么困难呢？如果像你现在这样子的情况来讲，如果你愿意妥协，那个代价可能更大吧，可能更多吧。撒旦也会在我耳边说，哎呀，不要吧，总要与人为善吧，你总要注意一下你的安全吧。当然有很多好朋友跟我说要注意安全，我不是说你们是撒旦，你们真的是关心我，但是撒旦会用各种各样的谎言来包装，也会告诉我们说，哎呀，你这个事情有什么关系呢，跟蔡同学讲说，哎呀，你就凹下去吧，不然的话你的处境会很困难。也会跟陈其迈说，哎呀，反正你是为国家好嘛，对吧，不然的话国家会大乱。也会跟谢志伟讲说，哎呀，36年前的事情就算了吧，现在台湾最重要是台湾的国际地位，在现在这个时候你们还吵这些干什么呢。也会各式各样的鹰粉跟他们讲说，国家安定最重要，如果被共产党给攻陷了，什么公平正义都没了。撒旦会用各种各样的谎言让你不知不觉的失去了价值，失去了理想，失去了原则，以至于最后犯下许许多多的罪。那么在这个耶稣在禁食祷告的40天，撒旦跟他讲什么？撒旦跟他讲说，如果你是神的儿子，你就把这些石头变食物吧。各位知道禁食祷告的时候是非常饿，人体的这个身心灵都非常脆弱的时候，就耶稣跟着这个撒旦说，撒旦退去，他说，人活着不是单为了食物，而是神口中说的话，是靠神口中说的每一句话，而这些话都记载在圣经上面。撒旦绝不死心，这个世界上啊， 比我们更有意志力的人叫做撒旦，叫做魔鬼。他会不断的用各种方法去试探，去打击你的弱点。他知道你的弱点在哪里，不断的戳你。有人为财，有人为名，有人为利，有人为了朋友，不管各种各样的理由，撒旦再一次试探耶稣。这一次呢，是在一个很高的地方啊，就是跟圣殿的顶端，跟着耶稣说：“你不是神的儿子吗？你跳下去，因为圣经经文上明白记载着说，他会为你吩咐他的天使，他们会用手托住你，免得你的脚撞在石头上。”这是圣经上面记得很清楚的。耶稣告诉撒旦说：“撒旦退去，不可试探主你的神，就是不要去试探主。”后来撒旦呢也不死心，就到了一个很高很高的山，去俯视整个啊当时的国度，看到国度的繁荣，撒旦就跟他说：“如果耶稣你俯伏下来拜我，这万国万民都是你的。”耶稣说：“撒旦退去吧。”他说：“因为经上记着说，要敬拜主你的神，唯独侍奉他。”我们拿这个事情来反省自己，有多少人为了自己的三餐温饱，或者是让自己过得更好，就像当你很饥饿，你很需要一样东西的时候，魔鬼来试探你，拿着面包告诉你说石头可以变面包。有多少人，包括今天在民进党内执政的满朝文武，你们觉得普天之下莫非王土，这都是我可以控制的。你看司法我可以控制啊，捡到枪掉了捡到烟啊，然后捡到300万通通都没事啊，绑标泄露底价判个6个月19万罚金18万没事，所有事情都是我可以控制的，连英国伦敦政经学院的某些人我都可以收买，万国万民都属于我，只要你跟撒旦交易，只要你继续说谎，这都是你的。耶稣怎么说？撒旦退去，因为圣经上说要敬拜主你的神。这个对于不是基督徒来讲，我想我们可以预表成为，这是你的原则，原则是不可以被收买的。进入广告之后，我们来看一看在华雅电视的第6集，就是英文的论文门。这一集非常特别的是，我们把蔡同学跟蔡同学集团还有蔡同学姐姐口中所说的话，笔下所写的事情，一个一个整理出来，我们用他们的话来看看他们到底说了多少谎。这段广告马上回来。
Why are people beginning to question the authenticity of Taiwanese President Tsai Ing-wen's doctoral thesis from her time at the London School of Economics?
My PhD viva was one of the most interesting in the history of LSE. By the end of it, my committee decided to grant me 1.5 PhDs.
On May 20th, 2019, Tsai Ing-wen's former instructor at National Taiwan University's College of Law, Professor Emeritus He Defen, held a press conference raising questions over why Tsai Ing-wen's doctoral thesis could not be found in any library around the world.
Think on all the suspicious things we brought to light today. Maybe Tsai will come forward and explain herself what it was she studied at school, what her core concepts were, and why her thesis disappeared. We certainly couldn't find it no matter where we looked. That is very strange.
June 10th, 2019. Cao Changqing, an exiled Chinese media personality residing in the United States, also asserted that Tsai's doctoral thesis was faked on the online political talk show True Voice of Taiwan. Former director of the Graduate Institute of Journalism at National Taiwan University and current True Voice of Taiwan host, Professor Dennis Peng, closely monitored the developments behind Tsai's doctoral thesis. He diligently spent 3 months dissecting the thesis on his show for an hour each day. Finally, on September 23, 2019, the Office of the President finally held a press conference to publicly respond to many claims made against the president's credentials. Where was Tsai's doctoral thesis? Why did the LSE library not possess President Tsai's doctoral thesis before? I think Alex made that very clear. President Tsai completed all tasks set forth by LSE to obtain her doctorate. That includes submitting a topic for her thesis, writing her thesis, and then passing her viva. LSE granted President Tsai a PhD for her efforts. It's probably not unusual for a thesis that was submitted 35, 36 years ago to disappear. I think a student wouldn't need to concern themselves with the whereabouts of their work 35, 36 years after the fact.
The thesis was written 35 years ago. Back then, they had different methods. If you judge the thesis using today's standards, then many things will seem strange. However, when we wrote dissertations back then, we adhered to the rules we were given.
Both Tsai Ing-wen and the presidential office insist that she received her degree 35 years ago in abidance with LSE's rules. However, the reason ThesisGate exists is because there are too many inconsistencies surrounding Tsai's doctoral thesis. It is an elusive and intangible thing, one that often phases in and out of existence, much like the diploma Tsai claims she has. Presently, the media knows about three different versions of Tsai's diploma. The first one is from 1984, which Tsai submitted when applying for employment at National Zhengzi University in Taiwan. The second is a reissue from 2010, which she used to register for the new Taipei City mayoral election. The third diploma surfaced right around when Tsai's degree came under question last year. It is supposedly a reissue from 2015. Tsai Ing-wen showed this diploma when meeting with employees of the Taiwanese social media website dCard. However, when responding to questions from Dr. Huan Lin, the head of the University of London Worldwide's Diploma Production Office, said on June 12, 2019, that students can only have their diplomas replaced once. Furthermore, the content and signatures in reissued diplomas will be identical to the original. How did the Office of the President respond? They offered this explanation. In 2010, the president participated in the new Taipei City mayoral election. She applied for a replacement diploma and even had Taiwan's representative office in London authenticated. That diploma was sent to the Central Election Commission. President Tsai did not need to submit another diploma to participate in the 2012 elections because the Election Commission already had it. In 2015, false information surrounding President Tsai's education began to surface, so we applied for another replacement diploma along with supplemental materials to prove the legitimacy of her degree. When she registered for the 2016 election, she did not need to submit her diploma again because she already did in 2010. Here you'll see the diploma the president used to register for the 2010 election. On it is a seal from Taiwan's representative office in England authenticating the document. The diploma bears the signature of the chancellor at the time. Here is the reissued diploma from 2015. It also bears the signature of the then chancellor. There are also documents here saying the president did obtain her degree. It clearly says that the London School of Economics conferred a PhD on Tsai Ing-wen on March 14, 1984. The University of London has strict rules when it comes to applying for a replacement diploma. In order to do so, one must provide a statutory declaration and apply for the replacement in person. If the original diploma is found after the replacement has been issued, then the replacement must be returned to the school where it will be voided. Most importantly, diplomas can only be replaced once. With such strict rules in place, is a reason as simple as the spread of false information good enough to merit a replacement diploma from the University of London? This is a replacement that can only be issued once. The presidential office has yet to offer an answer to that question. However, when a reporter asked when Tsai realized her original diploma went missing, the presidential office offered the following response. I'm not so sure about the timeline. For example, the president said that she lost her original diploma. But when did she realize she lost it? Around what time? Which diplomas did she use to register for the 2010, 2012, and 2016 elections? Were they the old ones or the new ones? It sounds like you didn't listen carefully to what we just said. I will send you a PDF later, which will explain everything. So can you tell us? I just told you everything. I said very clearly that she registered for the elections in 2010 by submitting a replacement diploma to the Central Election Commission. Isn't that clear enough? She doesn't need to resubmit the diploma for future elections because it's already on file with the Election Commission. Next question. When a reporter asked when did Tsai realize she lost her diploma, the presidential office very clearly dodged the question. Taiwan's education ministry is said to possess a legal copy of the diploma Tsai received in 1984. In that case, why was it necessary for Tsai to resubmit a replacement diploma to the Central Election Commission in 2010? If both the 1984 and 2010 diplomas have been certified by Taiwanese authorities, then why would there be a need for another replacement in 2015 to quell public concern? A dissertation must stand the test of an oral defense. I not only have proof of passing my defense, but I also have documentation proving that I did so outstandingly.
The methods by which we validate our education may differ, but my degree is absolutely real. My doctoral thesis can be found in English legal research databases at libraries all around the world.
In order to prove that she had a valid doctoral thesis and refute the LSE library's claims that it never had a copy of the thesis, Tsai Ing-wen referred to a 35-year-old library index. By doing so, Tsai claimed that the thesis did in fact exist, but it was simply lost. During her televised presidential policy platform presentation in January 2020, Tsai said that her thesis was listed in a legal research database. Chinese scholar Li Haimo examined the database in question. Unexpectedly, he uncovered that there were two different topics listed under Tsai's name. One topic was titled Legal Control on International Competition in a Transitional World, and the other Unfair Trade Practices and Safeguard Actions. How can a doctoral thesis have two different topics? Can a sloppy database entry like this be used to prove the existence of a concrete thesis? The contradictions behind Tsai's thesis don't end here. In 2011, Tsai released her autobiography in the lead-up to Taiwan's 2012 presidential elections. In it, she said that she proposed a thesis topic titled Unfair Trade Practices and Safeguard for Domestic Markets in a Changing World. She even says that a professor removed In a Changing World from that original title. Unfair Trade Practices and Safeguard for Domestic Markets is now the third thesis title we have been introduced to. Even if a person can't remember the exact title of their doctoral thesis, they can at least look it up using any number of methods. How can someone be so careless and so inconsistent with such an important detail of their academic career in their autobiography? What's even more outrageous is that in 2011, while giving talks at college campuses, Tsai uttered several more different thesis titles.
At first, the topic and title of my thesis was Safeguarding Domestic Markets. Later on, I added In a Changing World. Just like today's theme, I thought a changing world was something worth adding to my thesis. However, that topic was rejected and returned. I'll tell everyone here one more story. When I first attended LSE, I was expected to turn in a doctoral thesis because I was in the PhD program. The thesis required a topic. I studied international trade and competition. Back then, there was a relatively new concept in international trade, where foreign goods constantly entered a domestic market. Then domestic industries suffer. To safeguard is to protect a certain market. So I decided to title my thesis, Safeguarding Domestic Markets. It talks about how to protect domestic industries from the concepts I described earlier. I then added, In a Changing World, and had my advisor propose the topic to my advisory committee. They said that they can accept the first half of my thesis topic, but not the second half.
There are now a total of 5 different titles for Tsai's thesis. A few of those titles don't even pertain to the same concepts. How can a person be so inconsistent with the name of their own doctoral thesis? Tsai spoke about her education on many occasions. In 2011, during an election campaign rally, Tsai openly talked about her thesis.
I fell victim to my bad habits. One day, the school called and said, Ms. Tsai, can you come into the office? They said that my supervisor claimed he couldn't find me and that he didn't even know if I was writing anything. They said that he was very unhappy with me. I told them that I had finished my thesis and asked if they wanted to have a look at it. I showed them my thesis. When the head of my department saw it, all he said was, "Bloody hell!" He said that my outline was very well written and asked why my supervisor would say such things about me. The school arranged a new supervisor for me. This new supervisor took a look at my work and simply said, "Other students have to worry about getting their PhD. You don't have to." From that day on, I knew I wouldn't have any problems.
Even with an unhappy supervisor, Tsai Ing-wen managed to complete a thesis outline and have the head of her department arrange a new supervisor for her. That scenario seems extremely unlikely, but Tsai seems to thrive in unlikelihood, seeing how she says she graduated with 1.5 PhDs.
After a while, my supervisor contacted me and asked me to go into the room. I went in. My supervisor said that my committee had a very long discussion. They weren't discussing whether or not to grant me a PhD. Rather, they were debating whether they should grant me 1 or 2 doctorates. A total of 3 people sat on my advisory committee because my thesis pertained to 2 subjects, law and economics. One was my supervisor, the other was an economist, and the last committee member was a lawyer. Here's where it gets a little absurd. The lawyer complimented the portions of my thesis that discussed economics. The economics complimented the portions of my thesis where it discussed law. My viva was probably the most interesting one in LSE's history. In the end, they granted me 1.5 PhDs.
This astounding story about 1.5 PhDs is also in Cai Ing-wen's autobiography. This is how Cai describes the encounter in the book.
At the height of my tension, I saw my advisor stick his head out and call me over. He said, "Ms. Cai, could you come in, please?" I went over there as quickly as I could and saw that my supervisor was smiling. However, I was still worried. As soon as I walked into the room, my supervisor began apologizing, offering an explanation as to why they deliberated for so long. He said, "We had a very long discussion, but we weren't talking about whether or not to grant you a PhD. In fact, we were trying to figure out whether we should grant you one or two of them." At the end of the day, my advisory committee granted me 1.5 PhDs. I was granted a PhD in law, with an added remark that stated I had a strong technical background in international trade. The added remark is what constitutes half a PhD.
Another baffling detail in this story is the 3-member advisory committee Cai claims she had. The University of London's rules state that advisory committees which administer vivas are composed of one internal examiner and one external examiner. Supervisors to PhD candidates could never sit on a committee, much less preside over an oral defense. These rules reflect the deep and rich academic culture of tradition that English institutions are built upon. In fact, these very same rules were revealed when it was discovered that the son of Libyan dictator Muammar Gaddafi attended LSE. How is it possible that Cai had 3 people sitting on her advisory committee? She is yet to offer an explanation.
When you're in a PhD program, you are in charge of writing your own outline and thesis. If you fail to do either of those things, then you don't get a degree. I frequented the places where the PhD students tended to congregate. There, you can see many PhD students who were clearly much older than the rest. Why was that? Well, back then, it took anywhere from 5 to 10 years to obtain a PhD in England. You see lots of wandering PhD candidates who are waiting to graduate. Those were the ones that had a hard time writing their thesis. They say that you have to complete your thesis within 3 years. Why? Well, because some people believe that if you take any longer than that, then you'll never complete it. I probably spent 2 years writing my thesis. All things considered, I would say I was rather fast. However, I had this one classmate from Australia. She not only completed her thesis within 2 years, but she also had a child in between. Needless to say, I didn't break her record. I think she studied either law or political science. Either way, I think taking 2 years to write a thesis is already fast enough. But to have a child in between that, forget it.
An interview article the United Daily News did on Tsai states it takes an average of 8 years for someone to obtain a PhD from the London School of Economics. Tsai obtained not one, but two PhDs from the school in 2 years. One PhD in law and half of a PhD in international trade. Even until after Taiwan's presidential elections in 2012, Tsai maintained that she obtained 1.5 PhDs in 2 years. However, the presidential office would later claim the following during a press conference. The evaluation committee for the president's dissertation approved her proposed topic in January of 1983. By June of 1983, she turned in her dissertation. The president then completed her doctoral defense in October of that year as well. The University of London notified the president that she successfully passed her viva in January of 1984. It's not hard to understand how President Tsai obtained her PhD so quickly. It's a matter of basic math. The president enrolled in the school in 1980. She planned, wrote, and revised her thesis during her time there. By June 6, 1983, the president submitted her doctoral thesis. In October of that year, she successfully passed her viva, which is what they call an oral defense in England. She spent 3 years at the school. I don't think there's anything out of the ordinary with that timeline. According to the presidential office, Tsai Ing-wen had her final topic approved in January of 1983, which is roughly 2 years and 3 months from when she first enrolled at the school. If that is the case, then how can Tsai say she obtained her degree within 2 years? Furthermore, Tsai's student record indicates that she withdrew from her course 2 years into her enrollment. Is this a coincidence? What's even more unbelievable is the claim that it took Tsai a mere 5 months to write her thesis. The presidential office says her topic was approved in January 1983, and by June of 1983, she submitted her thesis. And if that weren't outrageous enough, Tsai Ing-ling, Tsai Ing-wen's sister, said that Tsai completed the thesis in Taiwan at a time when her topic hadn't even been approved yet, nor had she been appointed a supervisor.
I accompanied my sister to her doctoral viva. I went with her to England and spent 2 weeks there. I had a great time. So when people say that her thesis is fake, I find that absolutely ridiculous. The year before she submitted her thesis, we both were in Taiwan. I remember she wrote a whole bunch during that time. I asked her then how much she wrote. She said she finished over 200 pages. She forced herself to complete 3 to 5 pages every day.
The office of the president, Tsai Ing-wen herself, and Tsai Ing-ling. At least one of them is telling lies. The Tsai Ing-wen camp paints her academic endeavors as a sort of Cinderella story. Against all odds, a 26-year-old Tsai Ing-wen went against her supervisor and garnered a bloody hell from the head of her department. Later on, Tsai had to withdraw from her course in 1982 due to financial difficulties. However, by January 1983, she would suddenly become a genius in international trade law, submitting a completed thesis within 5 months. At a school where it took an average of 8 years to obtain one PhD, Tsai would get 1.5 PhDs in 2 years, something that had never happened in the school's 148-year history. This isn't a fairy tale. This is real life. How will this 36-year-long charade end? We still don't know. However, the truth doesn't just torment those that seek it, it torments Tsai Ing-wen herself.
好，非常感谢大家。我们今天早上的记者联访就先到这边，因为我们的时间还有限。但当初国民党也是打你这一块，就他们自己好像也都没有办法。
这件事情哦，
Everyone knows this by now. It's hard to dig up things from the past after a long time. Well, all right, let me put it this way. I understand my own affairs the best. In that vein, I can say that there is no problem with the thesis. The degree is real. Don't waste ink or page space on something so pointless and trivial.
In the next episode, we're taking the investigation to England. Tsai Ing-wen's team is attempting to rewrite history. But the true voice of Taiwan presses on, searching for the truth at the place where it all began, the London School of Economics.
正经关不了，关不了正经。华雅电视英文版的论文门现在播出第六集。刚才各位看到了，蔡同学集团跟他的亲友们所说的每一句话， 我们把它兜起来，前前后后会发现有多少的矛盾。这中间的矛盾为什么呢？因为人没有办法持续的说谎，因为持续的说谎前后没有办法连贯，就从这些他心中所说的、口中所讲的，我们可以一个一个当成他将来呈堂证供。但是只是不知道台湾的司法接下来要怎么样来继续演这出戏。刑事告诉部分，蔡崇元告我，我告蔡同学，蔡同学告林环强，告贺德芬，通通不开庭，连传唤一个被告或者想要问问被告你有什么证物，我们可以代为搜集一下，或者这个案子要怎么样侦办，有什么线索，通通一字不提。在民事部分呢，看起来也像虚晃一招，5月29号要开庭，但是这整个过程当中，我并没有看到任何一个有调查证据的企图心，因为我们申请证物的查扣包括调查证据都没有在进行。那但是我还是对司法呢抱持一心的希望，因为我相信啊，总有人在司法界是光是盐，这些人应该会为追求真相去唤起他们起初的感动，作为那个天平上面不二的砝码，我相信他们心中还是有一把尺。看完今天的整个华雅电视的论文门，很多朋友问我们说，那你要还要做到什么时候呢？大家觉得不错，尤其海外很多人疯传这个内容。我做个试调吧，我想各位同学啊，如果我们继续提供素材，其实我们的素材已经提供在云端了，所以华雅电视的朋友们非常谢谢你们啊，你们用这种各种方法后制剪接去做这个影片。那么就算我不做了，他们也会做。不过各位同学，你们希望这一个华雅电视的论文们能够做到什么时候呢？能够做到你们写一个日期好吗？你们写个加一，就是永远做下去啦，或者是你们写到2049啦，或者是你们写到今天就好了啦，就写个10月9号10号，或者做到哪一天啊，4月9号4月10号，看看各位你们觉得这个论文门中文版英文版在海外播出要播到什么时候，请大家留言。好，讲到今天呢是受难日啊，大家可能对耶稣基督不是很了解，有人可能说哎，他不就是一个凡人，我承认他在世上是个凡人，但是在他短短生命的30多年啊，大概33岁左右，因为很难算得很精准，因为那个时候也没有身份证嘛，也没有户政事务所，所以很多人亲眼见到耶稣在他这33年的生命当中所做的各式各样的神迹，包括了在一个婚宴当中正愁没有酒的时候，他把水全部变成酒。可能朋友会问我说，那你怎么知道呢？因为圣经上有记载。可能朋友会问我说，圣经上记得真的假的，你怎么知道呢？这我就没法说了。就像有人读莎士比亚的小说，哎，你怎么知道莎士比亚是真的？你怎么知道那是莎士比亚写的？或者是《论语》，你怎么知道《论语》的这个72个弟子写的东西不是杜撰的？你怎么知道这些人不是为了沽名钓誉？当然我们不知道啊。不过圣经上有一句话说，没有看到就相信的会更有福啊。那信仰这个事情是一种身心灵的感受，它其实不需要太多理智的论辩，因为人类的科学是有极限的。在我从事物理研究的时候，念物理的时候，我们老师每次上课动不动就告诉我们一句话说，以下我所说的东西都是建筑在一些前提之下，就是当你相信这个之后，才有我们接下来的物理，好吧？那这个就是我们的前提跟假设。还有呢，耶稣曾经在一个狂涛骇浪的这个水上啊，带着彼得斥责那个风浪，让湖面变得平静。还有曾经在行走在海上啊，在门徒的面前在海上行走的神迹。还有曾经告诉门徒说啊，告诉彼得说，你把船开到水深之处下网，然后就捞到了两船的鱼。诸如此类的很多，还有很多医治上面的神迹，包括了让瞎眼的得看见，让哑巴开口说话，让毕士大的池子上面的摊子得以行走，让血漏的妇人等麻风的病人得以医治，很多这样的例子。而耶稣行的最后一个神迹 是他要被抓的时候，西门彼得拔刀把要来抓他的大祭司的仆人叫做马勒古的耳朵刷一个给削掉，血流不止。耶稣过去医治了这个本来要抓他的人马勒古，然后他说了一句话，说赦免他们吧，因为他们所做事他们不晓得。在路加福音当中，杀了这个就是医了马勒古的耳朵的时候，他说的句话说到了这个地步由他们吧，在钉上十字架的时候说赦免他们，因为他们做的事他们不知道。那这个时候这个兵丁要抓他的时候，这个西门彼得拔剑把这个大祭司的仆人削掉一个耳朵，耶稣说了一句话，把他医治好，说了一句话，到了这个地步由他们吧，在路加福音中的记载。好，后来呢，耶稣的一生就行了诸多的神迹。那可能有人会问我说，耶稣行这么多的神迹目的是什么呢？这个就要回到圣经的本身，圣经整本圣经其实贯穿了，你问我圣经用一个字来代表是什么呢？圣经上如果有一个字的话，这个字就是爱。圣经上说爱能遮掩一切过错，90万个字当中它的核心就是爱。而且圣经上说，约翰福音说，我赐你一条新的命令，乃是叫你们彼此相爱，我怎样爱你们，你们也要怎样彼此相爱。圣经上中还有很多很多的金句贯穿了耶稣一生的精神，我在这边跟大家提。圣经上说圣经是说他就是道路真理生命，不借着耶稣没有人能够到父那里去，天国近了应该悔改，你希望别人怎么对待你，你就要怎么对待别人，这是耶稣对于律法跟先知所做的一个总结。还有不可以仇恨，要爱邻舍如同爱自己，甚至要爱自己的仇敌，为逼迫你的人祷告。不可以贪求钱财，不要忧虑吃什么穿什么，要先求神的国神的义，因为那些都会加添给你。不可以自己炫耀自己的聪明，要柔和谦卑，要学小孩子的样式。不可以炫耀自己的行为，不可以博取人的荣耀，要做世上的光跟世上的盐，让大家透过我们的好行为把荣耀归于神。不要论断人，免得我们被论断，先去掉自己眼中的梁木，再去掉弟兄眼中的梁木。不可以自以为义，要悔改。不可以把摩西的律法形式主义化，比方说坚持安息日不可以治病啦，或者是因为这样子要坚守律法的爱。爱是圣经上唯一坚守的真理啊，唯一坚守的最重要的真理。在这个耶稣的受难日当中有一些过程，我在这边跟大家做一个说明。耶稣传道大概3年多的时间，在公元30年左右的一个逾越节的前夕，他最后一次进入耶路撒冷，受到群众的欢迎。耶稣跟门徒一起吃逾越节的晚餐，这个晚餐就是有名的最后的晚餐。这中间当中呢，耶稣特别的帮所有的门徒洗脚，这预表着耶稣要服侍所有的人。他也告诉他的门徒说，大家要彼此这样服侍。在这个最后的晚餐，耶稣也预表说他将要受难，而且把这个场景讲得很清楚。他还说，你们当中有人要背叛我。可是这个时候他还拿起饼来祝谢，说这是我的身体为你们舍的，举杯告诉大家说这是我的血为你们所流的。好，那个时候呢就是有人要进来抓他，因为犹大背叛了耶稣，用了30两银子，30两的这个舍客勒，相当于差不多现在的4个月的工资4个月的工资大概10万到15万之间，出卖了耶稣。这个地方也可以看到，那个时候的一些长老们知道犹大的缺点就是爱钱，所以有钱能使鬼推磨，把一个耶稣最亲爱的门徒，而且口口声声说我们不会背叛你，我们将你到哪里我们永远跟着你的犹大，却是背叛耶稣的人。因为他透过在这个一个场合当中去亲耶稣的嘴，然后跟这个要抓他的罗马士兵串通好，他说我进去，我去亲哪一个人的脸颊，他就是耶稣，所以耶稣被认出来被带走。 那么最后犹大怎么了呢？他在耶稣受难之后，他忏悔，告诉大家说耶稣是他害的，被他出卖了，但是这一切都太迟了，他被后来自己在一棵树上上吊自杀。当然有人说这一切其实都是在上帝的安排当中啊。好，那么有关于耶稣受难，今天受难日，圣经上说世人都犯了罪，亏缺了神的荣耀，按照命定人人都有一死，死后有审判，基督一次被献，担当了多人的罪。在哥林多前书说，我们逾越节的羔羊基督已经被杀献祭了。罗马书说，基督在我们还做罪人的时候为我们死，神的爱就在此向我们显明了。在约翰福音说，神爱世人，甚至将他的独生子赐给人们，叫一切信他的不至灭亡，反得永生。在星期五过后的第三天啊，就是星期天，因为星期六呢是安息日。在那个时候有很多的妇女啊，有一些人到了耶稣的墓里面去帮他抹这个香膏。那么突然星期天再去的时候，有三个跟随着他的几个以前跟随他的妇女带着香膏到耶稣的墓当中，要去帮他去抹香膏，结果发现坟墓是空的，耶稣不见了。耶稣不见了之后呢，他四十天有在这个门徒面前显现，在复活之后他又来到世间四十天啊，在很多的门徒之间显现，而且告诉大家说，你不要怕，就是我啊，这不是蔡同学说就是我了啊，耶稣说你们不要怀疑，就是我是耶稣。在复活后的四十天啊，他去显现了他的种种的神迹。耶稣对大家说，天上地下所有权柄都赐给我了，所以你们要去使万民做我的门徒，奉父子圣灵的名为他们施洗，凡我所吩咐的都教训他们遵守，我就与你们同在直到世界的末了。在圣经上面也有很多地方预表了末世再来，包括了很多地方啊，有在耶稣受难之前所做的一些预言。主耶稣曾经在受难前预言说，在路加福音的21章11节，多处必有瘟疫，还有地方说你们要谨慎，恐怕因为贪食醉酒并今生的思虑累住你们的心，那日子就如同网炉会突然临到你。还有在路加福音说，你们要时时警醒，常常祈求，使你们能逃避这一切要来的事，得以站立在人的面前。这是路加福音21章所说的。也就是说，末世要来的时候有很多的景象，其中包括了瘟疫。所以在今天这个病毒肆虐的时候，我们其实要常常警醒，而且今天是受难日，我们要纪念耶稣基督为我们舍下的身体跟宝血。耶稣基督在断气前的最后一句话，也是今天夜深人静的时候我要跟大家分享的。耶稣在世上所说的最后一句话是说，在路加福音的23章46节说，父啊，我将我的灵魂交在你的手上。所以我要跟各位朋友们各位同学们共同勉励的是，我们将我们的灵魂交给了谁呢？我们把我们的良知，把我们的良心并我们的灵魂，是交给了你的长官呢，是交给了政党呢，交给了政治呢，交给了诈骗集团呢，交给了荣华富贵呢，还是交给公理、道路、正义、真理、生命，交给我们的上帝。祝大家平安喜乐，明天见。